Hey, Blues fans, this is Anthony from Texas Blues Alley. Today, I'm trying out something new. You guys will tell me if this is a good idea or not. First thing is the idea of a song guide. I'll explain what that is in a little bit. The second idea is the concept of a mini course. You're all used to Free Lesson Friday now. Usually with a free lesson, that's it. There's no more. You either like it or you don't. However, today I'm putting out a mini course. A mini course is where what you're watching is the free lesson. That's the first lesson in the course. If you want more information, you can buy a whole mini course for like 10 bucks. It's about an hour long. It's five lessons in all. If all you care about is the free part, then just wait till next week. There will be a new free lesson on something else. But if you like this lesson today, there's a whole mini course. Texas Flood Song Guide is the name of the course. And you can go get that for 10 bucks and go into more detail. Now, the whole idea of a song guide is something that I'm honestly, like, I'm really hoping that this is useful for you guys. You can tell me if it is or not. If it is, I can do a lot more of these. The basic idea is teaching a song note for note is complicated from a legal perspective and time-consuming. And meanwhile, there are those of you out there who, like me, you don't want to wait around for somebody to teach you how to play a song note for note. You're out there trying to learn it yourself. But depending on how much experience you have, it can kind of be like feeling your way around a dark room. You're not really sure what to do. So the idea of a song guide is that I'm going to tell you everything I can about the song without teaching it note for note, so that when you go and pop that CD in your CD player or put the download on your iPhone or something like that, and you put it in some slowdown software, you'll actually have some idea how to dig into the song. So in this first lesson, the part of this that's going out on Free Lesson Friday, I'm going to give you kind of a 10,000-foot view of the song. We're going to talk about the style it is, the tempo, the time signature. I'm going to talk about where your boxes are that you're going to solo in. I'm going to cover some signature things that Stevie did at different parts of the song. I'm going to talk about what to play and also what not to play for Texas Flood. Again, I hope this is useful to you. My goal is that you not just learn how to play, but that you understand what you're playing. So the whole point of this mini course, this song guide mini course, is to help you understand the song Texas Flood and have more confidence as you go to break it down. So anyway, let's get into lesson one of the Texas Flood song guide. Now, Texas Flood is a slow blues tune. Basically, what that means is it has a 12-8 time signature, which, if you don't care about music theory or anything, if you take a typical blues song and slow it way down to about 60 beats per minute, then you end up with slow blues. Now let's talk about the structure of the song, the different sections that it has, and the progressions that you'll find in each section. I'm basing this off of the album version. So I think of the song as having six parts. You've got your introduction, then you've got your first solo chorus, then you've got two verses that kind of go together, then you've got the main solo, then you've got the last verse, and then you've got the ending. And I separate the ending from the last verse because what you do in the ending is way different than what you do during the verse. So again, introduction, first solo, verses, main solo, last verse, ending. Six parts. And now let's talk about the progression that you'll find in each part. The overall progression for the whole song is a 12-bar progression. But we don't start there. We start with a weird little kind of four-bar introduction thing you're used to. And then he plays a lick. But what's happening under what he's playing there? What's the progression? This is important because if you ever get into a band with a bass player who doesn't play blues, he's probably just going to launch into a 12-bar progression, and then you'll be trying to play stuff, and it's not going to line up. What you need to tell him is that the progression for the introduction goes 1-4-1-5-1-5. Okay? That might sound weird, but here's how it plays out. As you're playing the intro, first bar is on the 1. Second bar is on the 4. Third bar, 1-5. Fourth bar, 1-5. Then we get to our main 12-bar progression. This 12-bar progression starts with what you call a quick four, which is where you jump to the four chord on bar number 2. Now, what happens at the end of most 12-bar progressions? It goes 5-4-1-1, sometimes with a quick turnaround to the five chord at the end of bar number 12. But if you pay really close attention to the bass part in Texas Flood, Tommy Shannon is doing something that's really common in slow blues, where you're playing over the 5 chord at bar number 9, playing over the 4 chord at bar number 10, then drop to 1 at bar 11, walk back up to the 4 at the end of bar 11, back down to the 1 to start bar 12, and then 5 at the end of bar number 12. Okay, so I've just spent a ridiculous amount of time going over a simple 12-bar progression, because if you really want to be good at blues, it's never that simple. Okay, you got your quick 4 at bar number 2. The rest of the progression is pretty standard, except when you get to bars 11 and 12. That's where you got to highlight the 1, 4, 1, 5. Now, Texas Flood was recorded in the key of F sharp, or G flat, if you prefer. And Stevie Ray Vaughan used E flat tuning. So basically what that means is tune down half a step and play as if you're playing in the key of G. So if you follow my lessons and you've watched Essential Fretboard, which I recommend everybody do, there's a couple of things that I teach you in that course anytime you're going to tackle a song. If you're going to follow the Essential Fretboard system, you would visualize the root marker here, the 4 marker at 8, the 5 marker at 10, and the octave up marker at 15. There are 3 primary soloing shapes that you'll be using that you should be familiar with. These come straight out of my 5 Essential Blues Boxes lessons. You could build your whole system of boxes starting with the 3rd fret, but I'll just highlight the ones you're going to be using. You'll primarily be using box 1, and then box 2 right above it. And then the other thing that you'll be using if you're studying the album version just a little bit is the box 1 shape in octave up, which starts at the 15th fret. That's why you find your root marker in octave up. So box 1 at the root fret, box 2 right above it, and box 1 an octave up. Now I'm going to talk about some suggestions for what to play when you're playing Texas Flood. This is primarily aimed at people who want some guidelines as to what kinds of things they can play and still sound like they're being true to the original recording that Stevie did on the Texas Flood album. If you insist on being super original and playing a version of Texas Flood like no one has ever heard before, then this doesn't really apply to you. Then just do whatever. I feel like I should warn you that maybe no one will want to listen to that. But if you kind of want to stick to the constraints laid out by how Stevie played in the original, then this section is for you. The first and most obvious thing is box 2. Okay, Stevie did a lot of Albert King influence bending in box 2. You want those bends to be crisp, lift, let it die, and clamp down with your picking hand at the top. Okay, and it helps to know more than 3 different bends in that position, since you're going to be relying on that a lot. Another thing that you can do to capture more of the Albert King sound is, instead of just picking these bends, try plucking them. You see, look at this finger down here. When you go to play a note on the E string in box 2, just reach your middle finger under the string, pluck it out, and let it snap down. Okay, that gives you a little bit more snap. Now let's talk about the use of box 1. This is obviously where Stevie played a lot, especially during the verses. And one of the most core things that you'll be doing in box 1 during this song is that little motion right there, bending on the 3rd fret of the G string, follow through on the 3rd, I'm sorry, bending at the 5th fret of the G string, follow through to 3rd fret of B and then E, circle back around to the 6th fret of the B string, and drop to 3. Another thing that you'll be doing to end a lot of phrases is, okay, walking down the bottom of box 1 is one of the key things that you'll do to highlight the end of a verse. So as we talk about playing smooth and tying things together, that brings us to the subject of transitions. So let's talk about the transitions that Stevie would do in the song Texas Flood. The 2 primary spots that you'll be playing are box 2 and box 1. When you need to move from box 2 to box 1, that's one of the most common transitions that Stevie would do. Just dropping, typically end your lick right there at the 8th fret of the E string, drop to 6, down to down to 7 on the G string, slide to 5 into a bend. Drop to 3, down to 5 on the D string, back up. Bend at 5 on G, up to the root note on E, and back down to the 3rd fret of the E string. Now, transitions between box 1 and box 2, your primary way that you'll do that is along the B string, following from something. Okay? Sometimes it can be direct, like sliding right in. Another time, it can be more deliberate, where you hear both notes. But that B string is going to be the primary root that you use to get between box 1 and box 2. And then, like I said, back down is typically going to happen along the G string. Now let's talk about some things not to play during Texas Flood. I kind of break these into two categories. First, the things that violate the very sound of the song. And then second, some things that fit within the constraints of how the song sounds, but are just things that Stevie didn't play. So let's talk about the things that kind of fit first, and then we'll talk about the things that are just flat out wrong. The first thing that would fit, but Stevie didn't play, is anything having to do with box 3. So we typically associate that with things like B.B. King would play. This is a slow blues song. You could easily throw that in there, and it would still fit the overall sound of the song, because this is not a minor song. But Stevie didn't play in box 3 in Texas Flood, except sometimes when he would transition, he would transition into box 3 and then quick out of again, but he would never channel B.B. King in the middle of this song. Another thing he wouldn't do is in box 4. Stevie didn't play a lot in box 4 any time, but he definitely didn't do it here. If you want to, I see people doing Albert King style stuff here. I think you get a better sound down in box 2, but anyway. So box 4 is something that you won't use a lot of. And then, of course, box 5. That is mainly reserved for playing during ballad-style songs, so you're not going to be doing any of that, really, in Texas Flood. And lastly, this is kind of a pet peeve of mine, what not to play? All minor pentatonic stuff. Don't play that junk. That's not going to fit with Texas Flood because it has no character. A lot of people who start to play blues but then just kind of stop developing, they learn the minor pentatonic scale. They learn how to, and they just kind of hammer on that stuff. It's not creative. It doesn't sound musical. Learn to play actual licks that sound good and mix in some major and minor. So when I say don't play all minor pentatonic stuff, I'm not saying don't play any minor pentatonic stuff. I'm saying don't just play minor pentatonic stuff. In other words, mix in some major. Learn how to do that, because that's what Stevie would do when he played Texas Flood. If you follow those guidelines, that should keep you from playing something that to an experienced ear is going to stick out like a sore thumb, like you didn't know what you were hearing, and hopefully make you sound a little bit more like Stevie when you play Texas Flood. So that's kind of my 10,000-foot view of the song Texas Flood. Hopefully for some of you, this is useful. If you really want to go into more depth, like I said, this is only the first lesson in an entire mini course that I have available for about 10 bucks. That has 5 lessons in total. What I cover is I go through the whole song and I point out signature things that Stevie did along the way. I point out some of the mechanisms that he used between vocal lines and soloing. I talk about the different themes that the solos had. Then in lesson 3, I give you a box for box breakdown exactly where he's playing at each point in the song. That's to help your ear recognition, to help develop your hearing. Then in lesson 4, I talk about how he extended Texas Flood in live performances, where the extensions would happen, different themes that he would use when he played live versions. And then in lesson 5, I actually talk about rhythm guitar ideas for Texas Flood. which is kind of odd since Stevie only really ever played it as a three-piece and didn't really play rhythm guitar. But you might find yourself in a position where you're at a blues jam, somebody else is the hot shot, you've got to play rhythm, you just want to play something that sounds good. So in lesson five of the mini course, I talk about some rhythm ideas. But if this lesson was enough for you, then that's fine. Just wait till next week. There will be more free lessons. Every once in a while in the future, though, there will be more mini courses coming out where the first lesson has more information if you're so inclined to go buy that. But anyway, I hope that's useful to you. And until next time, thanks for watching.